All right, thank you for staying with Daybreak. That question again, what more can be done to support SMEs? We're beginning the discussion right now. What more can be done to support the SMEs? You can text in 224222. The hashtag is Daybreak. You can also call in live 0719-777-777, 0742-961-343. This is coming a year after the president pledged more support for the SMEs and also came up in his State of the Nation address. Last year, he said that SMEs need to be supported because they create more than 75% of the jobs, and also said that the electricity tariffs need to be brought down. Operational costs, one of the biggest things that is hampering SMEs, and pending bills as well. The counties and the national government do not pay. Listen, here's a general outlook of what an SME looks like, and I want to show you coming up on your screen right now. It constitutes about 98% of all businesses in Kenya. The SME sector also creates 30% of jobs annually. And here's another big thing. The SMEs contribute 3% of the GDP.
So 98% of all business, yes, but only 3% of the GDP.
Exactly. And SMEs create 30% of the jobs as well. This is according to statistics from the National Economic Survey 2014. At the same time, 80% of the 800,000 jobs created in the year
that should be in
was
2014.
From the informal sector. Yes, that's the same time the National Economic Survey 2014 report shows that 80% of the 800,000 jobs created in the year came from the informal sector, which is dominated by SMEs.
Okay, let's take a look at a different report now. In 2016, Deloitte Kenya released this economic outlook. They shared the challenges that most SMEs face: inadequate capital, limited market access, poor infrastructure, together with inadequate knowledge and skills. In addition, SME owners are dealing with rapid changes in technology, that familiar word, corruption, and an unfavorable regulatory environment. And this has to do with national governments, county the national government, county governments, and so forth.
All right. And we still have more. There's the other challenges that they face is rapid changes in the technology and corruption, as well as like what you just mentioned earlier on. And also the SME life cycle, they say 400,000 SMEs do not celebrate their second birthday. These are the worrying statistics we were talking about. And this could be coupled with the challenges you're bringing up earlier on, Wahiga, because they don't have inadequate capital, limited market access. But they say that few ever reach their fifth birthday. That's according to the Kenya National Bureau of Statistics 2017. And there was another research that also shows that SMEs fail within the first 3 years of their establishment.
Why?
To find out why. That is another big question. And the Kenya Association of Manufacturers was trying to bridge this gap of limited market access in a festival you just had. Yeah. But why do they fail? Let's start from there. 3 years, they don't make it. And as they fail, they sink in with your money as well. The money which you didn't even have access to begin with.
SMEs start for various reasons to do their business. Some of them start in order to survive, so they have no clear plan as such. It's just for subsistence. So those ones are likely to fail faster in case that source of activity comes to an end or that market dies. There are those SMEs then who have identified a niche in the market and they start with that niche. You don't necessarily need to have done a lot of research. We know many people who their research is instincts, and they're able to know, hey, this particular service, if it's a shoe or a particular product, that they know there's a gap, so they go for that. So depending on how you start your SME, it determines very much how you succeed. Others fail, and you said it rightly, issues of delayed payments. You find that you don't have a lot of cash flow or capital. So if the county government retains your 1 million or your 2 million, which you had used to invest into giving them service, definitely if they don't pay within a year, you're likely to shut down. And then the banks also are not likely to give you money if you're a startup. They need to see a history. It has to be a serious innovation that, you know, you have serious partners who can give you guarantee, or you have a linkage somewhere with the market that shows a future, you know, a clear focus of your revenue streams with somebody with your market giving that guarantee for a bank, let's say, to fund you. So if you have such a network or a value chain that is very sustainable, such SMEs are going to last longer with that support system. So many SMEs are not clearly supported. They're also informal. So when you're informal, you are not recognized anywhere in the system. So when you try to trade with a serious business that can keep you in the market longer term, then they'll start requesting for certain things, you know,
that you cannot meet.
You cannot provide, you are not registered. You're also shying away from coming out clean and probably getting support for taxation services and such, so that you can be able to help. So there are various reasons why SMEs...
Why this happens. Victor, let me bring you in and let's take a look at the latest update in regards to SMEs. That announcement by President Uhuru Kenyatta that there will be a new credit scheme for SMEs. What do we know so far about that? And secondly, what are your thoughts about a theory by economist David Ndii that the real winners of the credit scheme will not be those who are receiving the money, but those who are lending it out?
I think for us to understand the credit scheme, we need to understand how banks price their loans.
Okay.
So there are three factors that are taken into consideration when you're putting out a loan. One is profit for the bank. Two is cost of the loan, which is the interest they give depositors. And the last is risk. So this is where the credit scheme is coming in. It's almost cushioning the lender from default. So in case, for example, you give Mary a loan, the government is saying that in case she defaults, we can be able to compensate you to a certain degree. Yeah. So that's basically what the basic understanding of the credit scheme. My only my opinion to that would be that if you're looking at SME financing, is a very complex scenario. It's not a to date, we are, SME financing is a financial institution only discussion.
Allow me to interrupt you on this. The credit scheme that the president announced, do we know how much? Do we know when it will be available? What do we know in terms of detail, anything?
I think it's in the process.
It's in the process.
It's almost like the way I've read is almost like a PPP, a public-private partnership,
okay,
where government would put in a bit of funds, but also private sector would be able to put funds to it. So that's the way I see it.
Do we know the numbers? Someone has put 500,000 somewhere there?
I think that's not very clear right now,
okay,
but it's just an idea that is being processed.
Isn't that where the problem lies? Because if you're not even aware of how that funds need to work for the SME sector, how are you expected to take it up? Because then there'll be a lot of bottlenecks and nobody will even access that money.
Remember, SMEs are not the ones accessing it. It's just it's almost like an insurance scheme for banks.
Uh-huh.
Remember, there's interest rate cap.
Yes.
So banks are saying we can't lend to SMEs because of the rate cap. So this guarantee scheme is almost bypassing the bottleneck of interest rate cap. So it's telling banks SMEs are risky. Let's absorb some of those risks.
I see.
Yeah. So, but for me, the discussion should be broader and include other stakeholders or ecosystem players in the SME finance discussion.
All right.
And for me, is can we look like, for example, already government is consolidating the three funds to what is called a Biashara fund. Mm-hmm. What is the implication of that? So that we are looking at access to finance in a broader perspective,
okay,
not just discussing one. Because if you go with one, chances of success might not be as much. Because as she rightly put it, depending with the stage of growth of the SME, you require different kinds of financing. For example, when you're starting off, even if you knocked at the bank and even had the guarantee scheme for you, you're still very risky. Yeah. So chances are, if you're proving concept, you're better off getting a grant. So can we have... for example, a strategy around
a grant versus a loan.
Yeah.
So at every stage, you should be getting different kind of investment in the business.
Okay.
So we start with a grant. We look at angel investors. We are looking at VCs, PEs. Then eventually, when you grow, then possibly you can be able to get, once you have traction, then you can actually approach financial institutions and be able to get the kind of credit that you need.
All right. We have a caller from Mombasa calling in this
Ibrahim.
Morning. Ibrahim, good morning. Salama sana. Endelea na swali.
Mimi nilikuwa nina maoni tu. Nilikuwa nataka kuuliza kwa nini sisi tuko na madeni mingi na sisi wenyewe wananchi hatuna kitu kwa mfuko. Unajua hiyo ni hatari kwanza.
Eh? Okay.
Yaani unakopesha na wewe bado uko mawaya hauna tatizo zote kinakusaidia. Alafu kitu mimi nilikuwa nasema, unajua hii madeni itafanya hii Kenya mpaka hata president mpaka yeye mwenyewe atakuwa anaogopa kwenda zingine ambazo zinatudai. Atakuwa anamwambia mwingine nenda. Mimi niko na kazi nyingi. Kwa hiyo ukiwa na deni unakuwa mwoga sana.
Yes, asante.
Hata kama ni ya shilingi tano.
Asante Ibrahim. Ibrahim is concerned about the debt levels in Kenya and he says that this way you have
not trickling down.
Yes, there's no trickle down effect. Speaking of trickle down effect, Mary, what has been your experience like running an SME yourself? Because you said that there's been concern. What is really bedeviling the SME sector? Because we could talk about it here on paper, but practically on the ground, what's really happening?
Okay. Mostly, the challenges that we are facing as SMEs is a inadequate skills and knowledges, yeah, and knowledge. You find that you really need to understand the business itself before you start doing the business. So you need to be taken through, you need a course, you need to be taken through a course. For instance, I'll give you an example myself. When I started doing business, I really did not understand. I was employed somewhere. And then I see an opportunity and I want to do business. So I do not have skills, I do not have knowledge. So I had to go back to school. I just looked in a paper and I saw an advertisement where there was Goldman Sachs Foundation and they wanted to help women to learn more skills about business. And that's how I started. That is how it was like a breakthrough for me. Yeah. Without the skills and knowledge, probably today I would not be in business. I would have actually just
stayed in employment.
Yeah. Yes. And again, another challenge that our businesses are facing is working with the government. You know, you work with the government and you get a lot of business, but again, there's a late payments. So instead of them paying you on 30 days, it goes up to 70 days, 90 days. Again, they also have another plan whereby they are saying, let's pay this the disadvantaged groups in on quarterly basis. Honestly, paying the mama mbogas on quarterly basis, this is they're going to finish them because we do not have financial muscles. Actually, the reason why the government said let's give the disadvantaged the women and people with disabilities because they wanted to empower these groups, to bring them and empower them. But now you come and pay us on quarterly basis, actually that just kills the business. So probably what we'd advise the government, can they restructure and see how they can be paying the SMEs on time, otherwise we might not be able to last longer.
Okay, before you come in, so let me allow Bwana Peter Washisha to come in and so let me also explain to us the credit needs of your members. What are your members looking for to be able to take their businesses to the next level? Can you give us cases where someone started with a stall in Gikomba, but within the next 5 years he was able to move to maybe the central business district? Are you seeing growth? And if you are, what is aiding that? Or are members just stuck, you know, where they started?
Okay, thank you. I can even start with myself.
Okay.
Remember, I started as a porter. A porter, carrying goods from this store to the other.
Okay.
From a porter, I went to hawking. I used to hawk in a town. Then I joined another store in Alobo West. From there, I came back to Gikomba. I started another store, became a retailer then after a few years, I negotiated with other retailers, I became to hold the sellers. So you can start as a simple person, but you grow by time.
Huh? Okay.
But the rate of growth depends on what you have or who is supporting you, because there are people who grow faster because of those people who are within the circumference. To me, I can say if this SME can have those funds and these simple people are looked at in another way, not like the normal way, say we have fund for youth, we have fund for the women, mm-hmm, and at the end of the day, you don't get that fund.
So your members are not accessing any of these funds?
We don't know whether they have that money. We don't have what my members does. We have the banks there. Yeah? Some of them does not have the collaterals. Mm. Some of them they cannot get the guarantors. Some of them they cannot even have them. I think those are Sherlocks.
Sherlocks are the best.
They are the best, but they are challenges.
You should ask Mary how she did it. She said she was able to get.
I think Nikumba is not very easy, but it's also very easy because also trust is not very easy. Mm-hmm. You may be a Sherlock there. Some people can take your goods. I don't take them nowhere because there's no that big document that we write.
Yeah.
You see? There's no affidavit that I give you 500,000, you give me back tomorrow. So it's a matter of trust business.
Okay.